Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
If you're amongst us as a person of prayer, and I hope you are a prayer, you probably learned from experience that sometimes prayer is difficult to understand. Consider, for example, that we might well pray for a man who has a physical infirmity, and that man is healed. And yet, we turn around and pray for another man with exactly the same infirmity, and he is not healed. Or, consider how a man who has very little faith, if any faith at all, prays and he's delivered, and yet another man who is a great man of faith is not delivered. Or, consider a man whose faithfulness is very paltry, yet God raises him up. And yet another man whose faithfulness is profound is not raised up at all. Surely by now you understand that in many ways prayer is mysterious, and we don't always understand it. Yet even so, the scripture reveals much to us about prayer that is not mysterious at all. In other words, there is plenty of truth about prayer that's very understandable. Amen? Therefore, it's perfectly possible for us to practice a life of prayer and to be a people of prayer, even if we don't understand everything about prayer. It's kind of like driving a car. I honestly don't know how it works, but I can drive it anyway. Amen? I didn't get a lot of this, by the way. So in this message, we're going to examine certain attributes or principles of prayer. The message is entitled The Practice of Prayer. The three attributes or natures or aspects of prayer we're going to be examining is the privilege of prayer, the persistence of prayer, and the power of prayer. So we begin with attribute number one, the privilege of prayer. We're going to be in Genesis chapter 18 to begin. If you have your Bibles, it's the first book therein. Genesis chapter 18, we'll be commencing at verse 16. The scripture says that the men it's speaking about here, let's remember last week's message and lesson. These were three rather mysterious personages who visited Abraham. Let me remind you that some commentators consider them to have been three angelic beings. Others consider them to have been two angelic beings, and the third personage was a theophany or manifestation of the Lord God Jehovah himself. And still others believe the three were the Holy Trinity, a theophany or manifestation of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Back to the text. The men set out from there, that's these three mysterious personages, and they looked toward Sodom. And Abraham went with them to set them on their way. The Lord said, in other words, one of the three personages said, "Shall I hide from Abraham what I am about to do, seeing that Abraham shall become a great and mighty nation? And all the nations of the earth shall bless themselves by him." "No," the Lord continues, "for I have chosen him, that he may charge his children and his household after him to keep the way of the Lord by doing righteousness and justice, so that the Lord may bring to Abraham what he has promised him." Then the Lord said to Abraham, "Because the outcry against Sodom and Gomorrah is great, and their sin is very great, I will go down and see whether they have done altogether according to the outcry which has come to them. And if not, I will know." Now I want you to notice how the Lord regarded Abraham in this passage. He regarded Abraham not simply as just another man. He regarded Abraham as a covenant man. Are you with me? This Abraham regarded Abraham as a man the Lord God himself had chosen. And we with whom the Lord God himself was in covenant relationship. And that covenant relationship bound the Lord to Abraham and bound Abraham to the Lord. Are you with me? And because of that, the Lord determined in his heart to make sure he included Abraham in his plans and purposes, regarding specifically the fate of the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah. And he did so in two ways. Initially, he allowed Abraham to know of those plans and purposes. In other words, he decided not to withhold from Abraham his plan and purpose, because he said Abraham is a covenant man. Amen? And then, as we'll hear later, he allowed Abraham the privilege of participating in those plans and purposes by interceding on behalf of those cities. That's the covenant privilege of prayer. Now understand, that privilege does not mean that our prayers force God to do our bidding. Amen? But it means that God chooses to take our bidding into consideration in making his decisions. That's what it means to be in covenant. And that covenant privilege, how many of you know, is also a covenant responsibility. You see, as covenant partners in Christ, we carry a burden of prayer, not only for our own sake, but also for the sake of other people. Such wise that in this covenant relationship between God and man, when we pray, things happen which would never have happened had we not prayed. And when we fail to pray, things will not happen that would have happened had we prayed. Why? Because we're covenant people. And the covenant God takes our prayers into consideration when he makes his plans and purposes upon the earth. Consider these words from Scripture in Hebrews 4:14. Since then we have a great high priest is passed into heaven, Jesus the Son of God, let us hold fast our confession. For we have not a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weakness, but one who in every respect has been tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us then with confidence, say that word, confidence, draw near to the throne of grace, that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need. The key word for us today in that passage was the word confidence. Where does that confidence come from? The confidence comes from our covenant relationship with Christ. Amen? We're covenant partners in and with Christ, and that gives us a boldness. It gives us a confidence. It gives us the courage to know that we have a covenant privilege. And that covenant privilege is coming into the very throne room of God in heaven, in the spirit realm, and petitioning him for things on our behalf and on behalf of other people. If we didn't believe that, why bother to pray? But if we pray, we should know why we're praying. What gives us the confidence to pray is the covenant privilege of prayer. And understand that covenant privilege means that when we pray,